As you see, my dear friend Samy has done something to his hand, and that's usually a result of him trying to do too many things at the same time.
It's kind of right, and sort of sets the theme for what we're going to talk about today, trying to do too many things, but you know, how do you handle lots of different sources of data? How are they complementary to each other? Where does the mobile fit in? And what do you do in the end game? How do you take all of that data and integrate intelligence, as we call it, to get some strong insights out? The case that we are going to talk about is innovation focused, but the process can be applied to any business problem. I'd like to thank our partners at GMI, not sure whether they are in the room, for their support in this project.
A little bit about ourselves. I've known Samy for 15 years now. The picture kind of tells a story about Samy. He's quite a passionate person. More details about the picture, yeah, maybe meet him in the next break and he'll probably explain. Samy heads the research business in ORC in Singapore. He has a master's in marketing research. He frequently speaks at conferences. He's been an adjunct faculty at SMU. So, like I said, I mean, does a lot of things with a lot of passion.
Thank you, Swami. Swami is great as well. He recognizes the greatness in people about 2 to 3 meters to his left fairly easily. We've shortened the names as you can see to get it easy for you guys. Incidentally, it happens that you know, I also know you for 15 years.
Oh, what a coincidence.
He's been at Standard Chartered in recent times, and he's going through this research reincarnation or transformation that we heard about yesterday. He's pursuing a master's in business analytics from NUS, so he's going to be one of the data scientists soon.
Well, I mean, talking about passions and interests, one common interest that we both share, sorry, this is giving me trouble, yeah. Okay, one common interest that we both share is food, and we thought, okay, if we could do something around the area of food, you know, it'd be interesting and, you know, drive us both. So what we, what Samy and his team picked up was to take the challenge of coming up with innovations in a category that's highly competitive and fairly routine, which is lunch options for quick service restaurants. Now, the difference here was that this was not a client-driven research, in the sense we did not have a brief to go with. So what Samy did was try and pick a topic where you know, there is some need for innovation, and then see how we could integrate various sources of data. Of course, like I said, the difference here is you don't have a clear-cut client brief, so it's that much more difficult, you know, to create a problem and then solve it.
There is sort of a brief. It was sort of self-generated. We are based out of you know, Tanjung Pagar area, and those of you who are local would know it's a, you know, lunch hotbed out there. But we picked up one category of lunch. Quick service restaurants, and we've not really seen any breakthrough innovation in that category. Well, most of the times what we see is price promotions, if any. So we thought there was scope to do something there.
Yeah, I mean, as many research users here in the room would appreciate, typically if you have a self-funded research, what you tend to do is look at all the past work that you've done over the years and probably refresh some of the insights and see whether it's more relevant today than it was at that point in time. And yeah, that's a typical you know, way we go around, go about things. And I try to call this the gut-based research. Why this? Because most of the researches you do usually has a starting point. You have a belief or a hypothesis that you're trying to test out. So you have a gut feeling, but you want to, you know, use research to prove or disprove it. So that's what we call as gut-based research. As against what Samy did, which was a little bit different.
And what we believe will drive inspirational insights is research-based gut. So you can tweet that. I think in this entire experiment, as we said, we acknowledge GMI, and Swami will walk you through.
Yeah, I mean, we had access to different sources of information. The challenge was not the number of sources available, but what to make, I mean, what to do with these sources and how to integrate all this. Being well connected with academics, Samy chanced upon this book on the changing values of Singaporeans, done by Dr. Siok and Dr. Su Jian. And these ladies have been tracking the changing values of Singaporeans for more than a decade using large-scale tracking studies. And Samy and his team discovered a lot of insights from these studies.
And I'll just make a quick point there. We talked about different sources of data, right? So for a market like Singapore, it was incredible, you know, how much data was existing out there to understand what we call the human condition. Academia actually provides quite a rich source of information. I think I see folks from the ACI Institute back there, and they are a rich source for information in Asia as well. So while we chanced upon this book, which tracked values of Singaporeans from 1991, we thought we needed to put those values in perspective. So we compared the Singaporean values with Australians at one end, being a neighboring developed market economy, and Malaysia for the legacy historic connections. And we were able to pull out good insights from that comparison as well. But more than that, I think, if you just flip to the previous slide, Swami.
Yeah.
More than that, what we did was we invited a bunch of marketeers, as you see there in the room, around 40, 50 of them, and discussed this book along with the comparative insights that we had. We had marketeers, we had account planners in the room, and all of that created a lot of buzz of trends in Singapore and gave us a more strong understanding of the human condition. Remember that we were doing this to generate inspirational insights for innovation. So we wanted to make sure that we have our ground, we are firmly grounded in empathy.
Okay, while we had access to a number of sources, like Samy was mentioning, there was still that one big piece, missing piece, which was, given that the category we were dealing with was a fairly routine-driven one, it becomes important to capture the mood and the feelings of the consumers around the actual experience. So we are talking about lunch, so typically if you were to imagine an office scenario, if somebody gets up at around 12 or 12:30 in the afternoon to go for lunch, what are the thoughts and what are the needs around that point in time? And that's where we thought that mobile data collection through mobile had a role. So Samy and his team set up an app to capture this these powerful insights around that particular moment. Now let's keep the study aside for a minute. We all know intuitively that when you're using mobile as a data collection tool, it should provide to an extent, more powerful insights around the service experience or the purchase experience, simply because the consumer with this access to this mobile device has a fair degree of freshness in his memory in terms of what the experience was about and can give rich data. Yeah, this is quite intuitive. But we wanted to really, quantify and put some figures around this. So what we did
That's the banker in Swami speaking. Intuition doesn't count. He needs hard figures for everything.
Yes, I mean, we do need, if you want to stand up and present with credibility, yes, you do need to back these, intuitions with figures. So what we did was a simple experiment that Samy will talk about.
Yeah, so basically we wanted to prove how good in the moment data is, in a very simplistic manner to back that intuition. So JMI helped us set up a very simple survey. We had one panel, traditional online survey takers, laptops, web browsing, and so on. And another panel where we had mobile app-driven survey. So respondents had an app, and the app would be triggered for them to take a survey. And we asked only one question.
Yeah, I mean, as you can see, we kept it simple. We just asked them to narrate, to rate their most recent service experience. We qualified by telling them it could be any service experience. It could be a bank that they transacted with, or it could be a, taxi that they took, or a restaurant they went to just before filling in the data.
So both panels would get this survey at different points in time, spread over different days of the week, and all the research design issues that we had to take care of in making sure that we are making apples to apples comparison. Intuitively, you would expect that if you are carrying a mobile phone, which all of us are, and an app triggers a survey and asks you to rate the last service that you just experienced, chances are that with a mobile app, you know, you will be closer to the moment of truth than otherwise. And if you want to put numbers to it, we found that the likelihood is like 40% higher that you would have experienced the service just within the hour if you were taking a survey using a mobile app. So that sort of proved the intuition, but look what it did to the data. So this is just a distribution of the scores, the satisfaction scores. And what is stark, staring in our face is the 130 versus 100 index of variation. So just to make this simple, the mobile app panel, you'll see that the survey scores are spread out, and they're not all clustered towards the mean, like the online sample. Swami can elaborate.
Yeah, I mean, this is again very intuitive. I mean, if you were to imagine a scenario where I've just had an experience, and given my access to the mobile device, I'm taking the survey immediately after, the experience is still fresh in my mind. And therefore, I use both ends of the scale as a consumer reacting to the experience. I use both ends of the, tend to use both ends of the scale much more than in a more traditional context where after the experience, a few hours after, go home, probably log into my laptop and try and do the survey. The finer details of the experience is missed, and therefore my responses tend to center around the average.
Again, that was intuition to explain the difference. So we dug deeper into the data and we looked at all types of services. So when you look at all services aggregated together, you saw the score 130, 200. But on the left there, if you look at high frequency services, let's say you're taking a taxi and you take four taxis in a day, and you know sometime in the day you have this app trigger asking you how happy you are with the taxi service, or at the same time you have a email coming in to ask you how happy you are, how satisfied you are with the taxi service. Now, what are the chances when you, if you're away from the moment of that taxi service, you'll all get mixed up. You won't know which service you're actually rating. So you would expect the difference in those metric to stretch out a little bit more, and it did, 135 to 100. But for low frequency services where it is possible for you to remember that exact service experience, let's say you're visiting a bank once a week and you know come home and take a survey, chances are you will still be able to relate to that experience as much on the mobile app triggered survey as against you know normal traditional survey, and therefore you see the gap closing in there, 125 to 100. So having got our facts and figures right, we dived into the experiment to help us bridge this gap to you know innovate around the quick service restaurant category. As Swami had mentioned, what we were missing in that piece is in the moment information, right? What are you thinking, your thoughts, feelings, impressions, just before you make that lunch decision? So we had a panel, asked them to maintain a diary for about a week. This is very close to what you heard Maharaj from Coke talk about yesterday. Our panelists were pre-qualified and asked around what time they were usually having lunch on a weekday versus a weekend. And just about, I think, 20 to 30 minutes before that lunchtime, the app would trigger and say, what are your thoughts, feelings, and impressions now that you're about to have lunch? That was just a plain open-ended question. And we captured all of that information in verbatim.
As you can see, I mean, while we're collecting data through mobile, the basics of research still hold. I mean, it does need to be engaging. It does need to have the right wordings for consumers to respond and so on. So we had to go through a few iterations as we didn't exactly get it right in the first you know, instance. So as you see, the three you know, examples there are the variations we did, the tweaks we did to the questioning. One of the you know, myths that we wanted to debunk was that as research users, we are worried when you do research through mobile, and if you want verbatim responses or the qualitative feedback, it will not be that good, you know, compared to traditional forms of research where you have an interviewer talking to a person on the phone, or even an online research where you are doing it at your own leisure, at your own pace. But what we see here is that as we improve the quality of engagement, in this example, the last one, we used a thinking cap animation. The average number of responses that we got per consumer, per respondent, was much higher, nearly twice as the plain vanilla version of the question. So this just shows that the device in itself is still able to, I mean, the platform in itself is still able to get rich responses, provided we are able to generate the right level of engagement with the survey.
And the responses actually got very rich. I mean, we had about 1,000 verbatim statements through this collection, through this exercise. You know, some of them, I'm not sure whether you can read all of that. But we didn't go through the traditional survey process. You know, there was some research reincarnation here. There wasn't any coding done or anything. We just decided to read them out aloud while in the room, so that the room would come alive with the lunch condition, as we call it.
Yeah, I mean this is just clever use of information in a non-traditional manner. I mean, typically you would code these responses and try and see patterns early on. But we thought early on in the process, if we have to really absorb all the insights coming from this powerful set of information, we should just leave it untouched and unadulterated.
To make the data richer, we had asked them to take pictures as well. So sorry, there was a question and there was an activity. So they took a picture, and the pictures actually helped us contextualize many of the comments. And just out of interest, we compared the online pictures, as in the pictures taken via the app-triggered survey with those taking an online survey. And you know, the app-triggered survey generated better pictures, twice the number of pictures, and so on.
Yeah, I mean, we were pretty overwhelmed with the amount of information that we had on hand, and we had to remind the team to stop collecting more and more information and then start integrating and try and interpret them. I mean, we were talking about a lot of conditions, human condition, lunchtime condition and all that, and we were worried about our mental condition. You know?
Well, we were quite sure that if we have a process to integrate all of this information, it would still work. I mean, we haven't shared every other data source that we used, including my lovely team from Singapore, from Hong Kong, and China, who also chimed in with their observation data. Singapore government has a lot of conversations that they're running on a platform called SG Conversations. We use that. There's an initiative called Singaporean of the Day that's running, done by an account planner. He takes ethnographic style videos of Singaporeans, understanding their lifestyle and so on. So we use that as well, and a host of other information, enough for us to get a good grounding on the human condition, as well as this rich source of mobile information to give us inputs to what people are actually thinking just before they're making the lunch decision.
Yeah, what followed was a day-long workshop where we, sifted through the information, tried and identified patterns, and saw what the patterns were telling us in terms of insights and all that.
That particular pose of lying down and actually swinging your legs back and forth is extremely important. It's the kids' pose for creativity. If you have young kids, you will see that they do that.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll show you a short video on what happened in the workshop, and then probably wrap it up. Thank you.
innovation issues with a little bit of tweak in the way you facilitate this kind of workshop. There's no reason why you can't use it for any other business issue. And that's what we're trying to end the session with before I take any questions. That, you know, mobile is a great source of information. There are several other sources as well, and you just need to find the sweet spot for mobile and take all of that data and information and integrate it in, you know, a nice fashion for clear direction to marketing.
Yeah, I mean, as a research user, I can also identify with this. I mean, Samy and I, given our long association, we, as long as it's non-competing categories, we tend to bounce off ideas of each other, and I was involved in the process because he likes bouncing off ideas with me and vice versa. And it was very, you know, what we should think of always when you're getting new platforms to survey people is that any of these platforms in themselves isolated might not be enough. Like somebody was alluding to the fact that we still have long questionnaires and all that. Yeah, I think there is still a role for all the traditional forms of research. It's just that we try to complement them with the new platforms that help us integrate all the insights better.
Last point is being self-funded and supported well by GMI. We had the liberty to do what we wanted to do. And I think going back from yesterday's case, where seven witnesses shot down everything that we were doing current in terms of research, I guess a lot of things that we are currently doing is at least 50% driven by what our clients want us to do.
Did you guys actually invite back the respondents that answered to the mobile app, or is it working through the client, which what we hear from Singtel yesterday morning?
We didn't invite the respondents, but there were lots of other things happening in the room. There was an account planner. There was the team who had done a lot of immersion in the category to get empathy. We had actually visited quick service restaurants, done observations. We work in the category, so we had access to UNA data and, you know, the qual data, concept test, and all of that. So around 10 to 12 of us had studied all this information. And it's a category that all of us are consumers as well, in a way, right? So it was close to, we could identify ourselves with the category. Unlike the challenge that we had from Tico on day one of the session dive, I think we were trying to innovate in the diabetic disease management category. And that I found that personally tough. You know, I couldn't relate as much to the category, luckily.
So Samy, you did end up with a few concepts that came out of the workshop.
Yeah. I could, if you go one slide or two slides.
You might go back to the video.
Not the video, actually. Yeah, we did come up with compelling concepts. I can't talk a lot about them because, of course, I'm going to try and market and leverage and sell this. There are some clear themes that you can see there. There's a theme around Singaporean identity that came around the insight of, a lot of talk in recent times around actually defining who a Singaporean is. So we build a concept around that. There's this maximizing concept that we've seen happening in Singapore. I've lived here myself 7 years now, and as much a Singaporean as many others in the room. I used to hear things like the fear of losing as an insight, but actually the way we learned from all of this exercise is that it's more about wanting to win on all fronts. There's a subtle difference there, and it manifests everywhere. If you're a employee, you want to win on the job, and you want to win on your personal life, and that's why we are faced with this work-life balance issue. And if it comes to lunch and stuff like that, you want everything. You want it fast. You want to pay less, and you want fresh food and so on. So we build a concept around that insight as well. And yeah, so all of these concepts were based on like very hard, strong core insights.
Yeah, the reason why I asked is so what question, the classic question that clients ask. I mean, you might do all this, but yeah.
So we are talking to one of our clients now, and hopefully in the near future you will see some of this in the market.
I just want to know how do we deal with such information overload? I'm a qualitative researcher, so sometimes it can be a nightmare for me. You see. So when you have like so much to sift through and analyze, so how do we then tell what's important versus what's not? So what goes into the basket and what doesn't go into the basket, right? So, and I believe sometimes less is actually more. So how do we deal with that? How do we reconcile?
One part of dealing with a lot of information, and the second part of knowing whether you've picked the right things. And I'll intentionally break those apart. I think dealing with a lot of information is an acquired skill, trained via training. So there are workshop facilitation training sessions that you can look up, and I can point you in that direction in the networking break. Most of this are run, unfortunately, outside of Singapore. Every once in a while, you'll have the training companies do a session here. The second part of do we know whether we did the right thing? Well, it doesn't end here. I guess we've built great concepts. I guess the next step would be to test this concept and validate. We think they are strong, but we would still need to test them.
Yeah, Samy, if I were to add to what you said, the other important thing is when you're dealing with a lot of data, is to know what you are looking for. So I guess that's very important. That doesn't change over historically over the last 40, 50 years. The problem definition is very important. So if the problem definition is clear, then yes, definitely less is more, because you're not going to waste time looking at information that is not in any way connected to the problem you're trying to solve for.